I had two people asking me during the break about using solarization with ivy, which is really interesting. Nobody's ever asked me that before. And here's my thought. I would not, if you're going to do ivy, which if you do it, please tell me how it works. Cut the ivy down all the way, as much as you can. Because ivy, the leaves on ivy, those big green leaves, dark green leaves, they have a really thick cuticle on them, that waxy cuticle, and they're really tough. The new growth, as it comes up, you know how it's bright green? It hasn't developed that cuticle yet. So in fact, if you're going to spray ivy, that's the time to do it. So if I were doing ivy, I would dig it out as much as I could and solarize on top of it and then see what happens. Give it some time and see what happens. Really curious to hear about that. Yes?
We have established, really established trees growing in between your ivy patches.
If you have established trees between the ivy patches, are they far enough apart that sun will get in?
When you get
it, will it get sun? The whole thing about solarization is you have to have the sun hit the soil.
Oh, so it can enter the leaves?
Yeah. And it can get through the trees.
Yeah.
There's not too much shade. So solarization will work where it's sunny. It will not work in a shady spot.
But it won't be damaged to the trees?
It won't. It should not damage the trees. Should not damage the trees. Okay. Everybody's hydrated and happy?
Yes.
Good. Okay, so the next method I'm going to talk about is a lot like digging. It's using a sod cutter. Anybody ever used a sod cutter? Sod cutter is this machine that goes along. It has a blade under here. There's a blade, and you set the angle to go down 2, 3, 4, I think it's up to 12 inches, depending on how deep the roots go. And you basically, it's sort of self-propelled. You have to make sure you direct it. You rent these things. It costs about $100 a day. And it cuts out a big ribbon of soil. So if you have like an odd shape, a big ribbon of grass. If you have an odd shape, it's really great to use that. And again, if you have the fine red light root grass, it's gone. If you have Bermuda, see if you can figure out how deep it's going to go. You know, you do it in combination. This is one of the methods you use. And in fact, when you watch our show, Diane Downey up in Vista, first she used a sod cutter, and then she did the cover and smother method on top of it. Very important. Mark your sprinkler heads, and if there's any gas left. Right? Because otherwise, you get the picture. So again, if you've got the nice fine thread-like root grasses, you can take these pieces, pile them up, let them compost, put them back in the garden. If it's Bermuda, you want to send it off to the green waste. Because then when they compost it, that'll kill the Bermuda. And it'll be somebody else's issue. Anyway, this is really quick. It's a little bit of a money investment. It's not nearly as labor intensive as digging out your sod. So if you have a big space, it's a really great way to do it. What I don't ever want to hear anybody suggesting, I hear laughter. Okay, so what does a rototiller do? It digs the dirt and breaks up big clods. And people think, oh great, I'll just pick up the clods and throw them away. Well, if you have that nice, fine, red-like root grass, that's fine. But if you have Bermuda, well, let's see.
You have more
Bermuda. So Bermuda has, remember I said all these joints, are they all the nodes? All those places are where these pieces can root. So if you chop it all up, you got lots of Bermuda. Don't do that. I was giving this talk or a version of this once up in Fallbrook, and at the library in Fallbrook. There was a small group, and this one older woman, it was a nighttime presentation. She gasped when I said this. And we all looked at her, and she said, I have a guy coming at 7 o'clock tomorrow morning to order till I'm from here. What do I do? Totally panicked. Totally panicked. Okay, so don't rototill. The other thing about rototilling, there's two other things that are bad about rototilling in general. One is, We rototill because we think that we're fluffing up the soil and making it easy for roots and stuff like that. Really, we're not, because when the soil settles, it compacts more than it was before. And also, in your soil, there are, you know, there are microbes in the soil that live there naturally, and they're very finely defined in terms of where they are, how deep they are, based on temperature, nutrients, food sources, all kinds of moisture, all kinds of things. When you rototill, that's a natural disaster for that, because you're mixing them all up. You don't want to rototill. You want to turn as little as possible. You want to turn the soil as little as possible. Okay, now we get to a little bit of controversy, herbicides. So all this work, wouldn't it be nicer if I could just spray my problems away? Yeah, it would. So that's where you get into some interesting things. There are so-called natural herbicides. Natural herbicide would be something derived from something in nature. So for example, there's vinegar, horticultural vinegar. Okay, this is this one's got yucca extract added, which is a surfactant, so it makes it stick on the blades. Horticultural vinegar is between 10 and 20% acetic acid. This one's 20%. Anybody know how acidic household vinegar is? This is 5%. This is a pretty acidic one. 4 or 5%. So this is between 4 and 5 times as acidic as your household vinegar. So when you spray this stuff, you want to make sure that you are wearing goggles, long sleeves, gloves, you know, protection, because this is really acidic. And even though we think about it as being a natural herbicide, it's probably synthesized in a laboratory. It's probably not extracted from whatever. Yes?
What is the name on the label?
This one is called, this is from a company called OSM. So here's the interesting thing about horticultural vinegar. Some of them are registered with the EPA as herbicides and can be advertised as such. Others are not. There's no difference between the vinegars. It's expensive for the companies to apply for and be granted EPA approval and to go through OMRI organic certification. So I can't tell you to use any horticultural vinegar, right? And neither can you. You can't tell people to use one that's not, you know, specifically says weed killer, grass killer, but you can tell people to look for ones that are. Did I do that right, Scott? Thank you. Yes?
This is what I was asking. Does it say horticulture vinegar on there?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Hold on, let me just look. Yes, natural horticultural vinegar.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Then can you repeat the last thing you said?
Yeah. Natural, okay, so hold on. This is actually from the fermentation of grains. So this is a natural source. So what I said to you was there are vinegars where the companies have put them through EPA approval to be used as an herbicide, and also ones that have gone through organic certification. All of those cost money. So if you're going to tell people that they can use horticultural vinegar to get rid of grass or lawns or weeds, you can use it for weeds too, your responsibility is to tell them that they can use, that they should look for the ones that are approved for that use. If it doesn't specifically say it's approved for that use, don't recommend it. Okay? Make sense? Alright. So I'm going to talk about spraying methods in a minute. There are other kinds of so-called natural herbicides. And again, these work great for the grasses that have the fine thread-like roots, because what they do is they destroy the leaves. The acid destroys the cells in the leaves. And then, of course, once the leaves are gone, then the roots don't have any nourishment. Then, so this is called a burn-down product. Burn-down burns it from, you know, burns the leaves down. Then there's ones like this. This is an ammonium nanoate solution. A lot of these burn-down products are made from things like D-limonene. D-limonene is derived from citrus peel. You know those those orange cleansers, the detergents, the degreasers and stuff, it's all from the same thing. In fact, they also make flea collars using that same ingredient. And so what it does is it breaks down the waxy coating on the leaf, and so the leaf just desiccates. And it worked within a couple of hours. And you can buy it concentrated, or you can buy it ready to use. Pretty expensive. You know, on a per unit basis, it's pretty expensive. And it will, again, a burn down product, it will kill the tops, it will not kill the lovely fleshy roots that Bermuda has. Now, they will tell you, you could do multiple applications, and eventually Bermuda will run out of energy, right? It will give up the energy in the stems. Eventually it will die. How long that will take? Who knows? How many applications? Who knows? These, so that was the vinegar. Vinegar is horticulture vinegar. Well, it's funny. I was going to tell you that vinegar is cheap. This stuff is cheap. This gallon of horticulture vinegar, Grangetta sells it for like $55.
Oh,
yeah. You can buy it online for a lot less. Kevin Grant, I love Grangetta's, they're a show sponsor, whatever. It floored me when I found out how much this was. But you can buy it online for like $16 or $18 a gallon. So look for that.
Then what is this distilled white vinegar good for?
The household vinegar? I use it on everything. I mean, I cleaned my teapot this morning because the acid will descale, you know, teapot. You can use it for cleaning windows. You can use it in the garden. You can use, again, I can't tell you you can use it in the garden. But people do. Mostly to kill weeds. Yes.
That was just my question. I used to kill weeds.
Yeah,
kill weeds. I wanted to make sure it was okay.
Yeah, it is. You know, if people tell you they're worried about the acidity and what's it going to do to their garden, our soils are so alkaline, our water is so alkaline, that the small amount you're going to spray isn't going to make a bit of difference. So don't worry about that. On your handout, on the back side, should be a resource list, and it lists some of the sources of these products. By the way, if you're going to use vinegar or the other materials, always best to do it in when the grass is actively growing, when it's not windy, because you don't want drift. And the vinegar, they say to use in the late afternoon. This is another example. This is the one that has the delimonene Avenger. I think it has a new name. I looked it up the other day, and they've given it a new name. These things get bought by different companies. Again, always read the directions for use. Yes?
I noticed that on your resource list down at the bottom is a colorant.
Yes, I'll talk about that in a second.
Okay.
Then we have Roundup. I honestly, at this point, I almost don't know what to say about Roundup. When I did research 7 years ago on Roundup, there really was no data. I looked for data. There was no data that showed that Roundup had any kind of cancerous effect, teratogenic, thank you. Teratogenic, which means that your babies are born, you know, with deformations. The big issues at that point were aquatic use, and there were a bunch of epidemiological studies that had been done in farm areas where the people had been given a list of maladies, you know, do you suffer from, you know, huge problems, and then asked for a list of the materials that they use, pesticides and herbicides. Well, they were long lists. And somehow that was being manipulated to say that, see, Roundup causes this. Well, there's no causation there. And there wasn't even a statistically significant correlation because there were so many things these people were using to Roundup. And the other thing is, that's in a farming situation where this stuff is being sprayed or applied all the time. If there's anybody who's going to suffer, that's the situation. Our situation is totally different. We're people who might use this once every couple of years or on a specific project, and then that's it. You're done. I mean, I never want to say to people, spray. To me, it's the last resort. But there are times when what else is going to work? Ivy, Equisetum, Bermuda grass. And if you've done your sheet mulching, or you've done your solarization, and you get those couple of sprouts that you just can't get rid of, is it that bad? You know, there's so much, especially now, you know, everybody wants to declare it as a carcinogen. And I have to say that I'm confused. I'm worried that there's such a backlash against Monsanto that really the problem is people hate Monsanto and the things they've done because of the Roundup Ready crops and all that. You know, Monsanto is such a boogeyman now that I think we've lost the ability to separate the product from the company. I suspect that you are not going to get many people who are going to be willing to use Roundup at this point. It's too scary. People just don't understand. I don't understand. I know there's new research out there. I have not had the opportunity to look at it. I am a biologist by training, so while I'm not, you know, this is not my specialty necessarily, I'm not an epidemiologist. When you look at the other herbicides that are on the market, and look at their MSDSs. So an MSDS is material safety data sheet. Is that a familiar term to people?
No.
No. Some people say yes, some people say no. Every product that gets manufactured in the United States is required to have a material safety data sheet. OSHA requires it. Look these up because they list the major ingredients. They will tell you, like, in emergency, do this, in a fire, do this, you know. They list all of the experiments that have been done with these materials to tell you what the LD50 is, the lethal dose, 50% lethal, for rabbits and rats and blah, 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 blah. It will tell you the medical treatments should you get exposure, what kind of issue, you know, like if you get skin exposure, wash it and do this and that. If you get it in your eyes, go to the emergency room. If you ingest it, induce vomiting or don't induce vomiting. I mean, there's all these different things. It'll tell you the carcinogenic, how carcinogenic it is. It'll tell you the teratogenic. Thank you. I'm tripping over that one today. The teratogenic effects. All of that information is on these material safety data sheets, and you can find them online. And so when you look at glyphosate, which is the active ingredient in Roundup, material safety data sheet doesn't really. You know, if you drink it, it's going to give you diarrhea. There's not a whole lot. Should they be updated? We have to look to OSHA for that. But this has been the way it's been for 40 years, yes.
I recently had a person come from a, you know, professional, well-known pesticide company, and I was asking him about Roundup, and he said that won't hurt anything in your yard, you know. It's a little creature.
Right.
Won't.
Right.
Very safe.
Right. And I mean, I did all of this research, as I said, years ago, and it's absolutely what the research says. Now, if you look at the material safety data sheets for the other herbicides that are on the market, they are terrifying. They're terrifying. And for your personal use, however you decide to deal with that information, the only Roundup product that I would touch is the one that doesn't, are the ones, because there's a million on the market, are the ones that don't say fast acting. Because when you look at the ingredient list on Roundup, it will tell you glyphosate is the active ingredient. But because people want to see response right away, they add other herbicides to some of these. And those are the ones that are really scary to me. So, Don, did you have a comment? Okay.
This
one
you contrast the horticultural vinegar safety to Roundup
safety. Okay, hold on a second. So definitely stay away from the ones that have other active ingredients other than glyphosate. I would never touch those personally. But the ones that have just glyphosate as an active ingredient, that's a personal choice. But you'll get questions. You're gonna have to decide what you're gonna say. Glyphosate as compared to horticultural vinegar means to look at the material safety data sheets.
The LD50, the
you know, I haven't done that.
Eyes.
Yeah, I haven't compared the material safety data sheets, but that would be an interesting exercise for you guys to do. Is, you know, how does compare? In terms of efficacy, there's no question that Roundup is going to be effective. The way Roundup works is that you have to apply it onto actively growing healthy grass. It goes in through the leaves, it gets absorbed by the cells, and it gets translocated, meaning it gets moved through the plant from the leaves down to the roots, which is why it's so effective. And it inhibits an enzyme that's involved in photosynthesis. It's not an enzyme we have. Okay, so it's not, it doesn't target what we do. But that's why you have to have it on actively growing turf. If you spray it on something that's brown, you're wasting your time. And if you're gonna spray it, you wanna do it 3 times. Spray it once, wait 2 weeks. First of all, you have to get your grass going. Spray it once, wait 2 weeks, keep watering, spray it again, and you'll probably have to do it 3 times, and at that point, it'll be gone. It works great on ivy. Yes?
One, you do it once, you wait 2 weeks. You do it the second time,
yes.
You wait how many weeks?
2. And you do it 3rd time. Yeah. You know, all of these methods I'm telling you can be used in combination. Do your solarization, see what's left, try the horticultural vinegar. It's just like I can, right? You go with the least noxious first, and then you go up the scale as you have a harder and harder time dealing with whatever it is you're dealing with. Okay, so am I politically correct enough? I have to be honest with you, this is a difficult one. And Roundup is, you know, glyphosate's being prohibited in various countries. I'm not clear whether that's data, you know, based on data or whether that's based on emotion. That's the very vagaries of human nature. So regardless of what you're going to spray, if you're going to spray, what you want to do is, of course, always look at the manufacturer's recommendations and follow them. Long sleeves, shoes, socks, hat, you know, filter, whatever mask, whatever it is, glasses, make sure you follow them. You don't want this guy. And you sure as heck don't want, well, this guy isn't too bad. You don't want that hose end, you know, where you put in, the little thing goes on the end of the hose and it says, fill to here, and then, you know, those things are never accurate. You really want to be accurate. So you want some kind of spray, big spray device. I thought this was going to be the answer to my dreams. Because the 1 gallon, 2 gallon sprayers don't give you enough volume. The 3 gallon are really heavy. They're really heavy.
Yes.
I'm not very tall and they're heavy. And they're hot and you want to do this early in the day. Right? Well, before you always want to do it early in the day because it's going to be the coolest for you having all that gear. So this sprayer, which is unfortunately no longer made, the way you pump it up is by rolling it. It pumps itself. That sounds cool, doesn't it? Except what it really needs is a pump and then this to supplement it. Because the first time I used it, I realized I had it full of liquid and I had to go walking around the street. Yeah, it was pretty funny. But it works pretty well. So look for, but the idea of one that you can pull behind you is really nice. Really nice. Make sure you've got your dilutions correct. Make sure that you have a separate set of measuring spoons and measuring cups, if you use cups, for working with this stuff, because, and you dedicate a sprayer to herbicides, because you never want to mix. And the other thing is, if your husband, no offense guys, if your husband does this, make sure he cleans it when he's done. And will you get my husband to clean it? The other thing that happens is, So you've got this area, and you're going to spray it, and you start off, and it's, you know, big as this room. That's not unusual. And so you start in this corner, and you're spraying, and you're spraying, and you're spraying, and you're spraying, and then you go, wait, did I get that spot?
No.
Where was I? You know, like, I always have kind of a pattern in my mind when I start. But then, how wide was that strip? And did I get that corner? So here's the solution to that. I learned this from the pros at some point. There we go. See this? These are colorants. These are like heavy-duty food coloring. You get them on your hand, they'll stay for a few days. Okay, when you watch our show on how to get rid of grass, you'll see where I'm handling the grass, my fingers are blue. Because we sprayed this in somebody's garden. The thing to know, and you can get these at where the big guys shop, you know, like at Ewing, Grand Jetto's, Hydroscape. I think Hydroscape just got sold. I don't know if they're going to change the name. I haven't noticed yet. But anyway, where the professionals shop, unfortunately, they come in big bottles. You'll never use this much. You'll never use this much. But it's not that expensive, and it's worth the investment, because once it's blue or red or purple or green, not green so much, the green is like that awful, terrible green, you're going to see exactly where you sprayed, right? Yeah, absolutely. The other thing to know is, if you use the vinegar, you need to make sure that you've got a color that's compatible in an acid solution. Hopefully they'll know that at the store where you buy it. So you've always got to talk to the people at the store and tell them what you're doing. And once the grass is dead, what do you do with it? Well, it's organic matter. So what are you going to do? What are you going to replace it with? If you're putting in a patio or a walkway, something that needs a smooth surface, dig it out, compost it, send it to the green waste, whatever you're going to do, depending on what kind of grass it is. If you're going to plant and it's really dead, I just leave it. Just, you know, I like to, when I design gardens and install gardens, I like to create mounds. I just bring in the soil and fill it, or plant right through it. So, we're running out of time. I don't know how I did that, but so, you want to have your spray and your supplies. That is not a self-pumping one, fortunately. This is your color indicators. And this is the goal. This is the goal. So when people say to you that, okay, so you're going to go through this whole thing with people about how to get rid of their lawns, and then they're going to say to you, okay, and then where do I put the place? What do I put back? What do they ask for most often? I'm just going to replace it with a water-wise lawn.
Succulent.
Yeah, good luck, water-wise lawn. We'll talk about that in a second. Succulent. So remember I told you lawn is default? I want to encourage people to do something different. Think outside the box. It doesn't have to be a low, single monoculture. The monocultures are impossible to take care of. That's part of the problem with lawn. And it's boring. Okay? It's just freaking boring. You can do something beautiful like this. This is Deborah Carl. She's a designer in Encinitas. That's low, but it's a mixture of grasses and succulents and all kinds of things. You know, do you need even a low space? This is in front of my house. I replaced, well, I never had grass, but I planted a dwarf, sprawling bougainvillea. It's the only bougainvillea I actually like. Mm-hmm. And planted perennials. The color's a little wrong. It should be a little more coral than that. It's called Bengal Ice. And it's got a variegated leaf, and the flowers come out coral, and then they turn pink. It's just gorgeous. They could plant natives. Why not? Look, you got your ceanothus. You want a low, flat area? Plant ceanothus. Ground covers. Who was talking to me about Diamondia? Someone was talking about Diamondia. This is a pathway. Okay, this is an access route. Diamondia is tough as nails. South African native, tough as nails, grows this deep, this tall rather. You can drive on it. Spreads by rhizomes. The only downside of Diamondia is it's a seedbed.
Yeah, you can see the weeds.
You gotta weed it. Mm-hmm. But if you can keep on top of the weeds, it's awesome.
And me,
how does it tolerate dog urine?
No.
It does.
No?
It does or doesn't? I've never seen a problem. He says no.
Mine does okay.
Maybe it does okay.
Having the strip between the street and the sidewalk on the trees where they all pee. And no, never a problem. Because if you water at least twice a week in that area where you know, you can dilute it. Dilute it down, but it's never turned color, died or anything.
Do you have to weed yours at your little greenway a lot?
Yes, yes. Not a whole lot, but yes, I do. Aspoa is a big one.
Yeah, grass is.
Yeah, it's a big one.
Okay, so I brought some of these things with today. This is cotula, which is brass buttons. I grew this stuff years ago. I'm just going to pass these around. And wherever they end up, they end up. So cotula brass buttons has this beautiful ferny green leaf, grows about this tall, and then you get these flowers that come up above it. When I first moved into the house I live in now, it was a disaster. But there is a space between the houses, the house and the guest house, that was so hard I could not get a shovel in. It was hard baked. And somebody in my neighborhood gave me some cuttings of this. I'd never seen it before. We're talking almost 30 years ago. And they planted it, and this stuff just spread. It was awesome. And so by the time I was ready to actually do something there, I pulled all of this out. The soil was all nice and soft. And there you go.
I have this. It's awesome.
It handles some foot trespass.
So if these look like to bloom, they would need water. But are they like?
They're all waterless. They're all very waterless.
So really, you don't need irrigation systems for this?
Well, no. Yeah. Nothing gets you established without irrigation.
Right.
So, I mean, there are ways to get around it, but you do want an irrigation system. And it establishes a year or two. So you do want an irrigation
system. And
then? Well, and then it's occasional water.
Do they flower in the summer?
They're flowering now. But they flower, do they flower through summer? I can't remember. They take some foot traffic. Carapia, I don't have a sample of this, but Carapia is Lipia nodens, which is a native, believe it or not, of Japan. This has been Carapia is the brand name, and this has been selling a lot recently. It's a new one. Been tested by UC. It's very low growing. Lipia nodens, nodiflora, has been used as a ground cover forever in California. This is a sterile variety, and evidently it fell out of favor because it just kind of went everywhere. In the 50s, I think, in the 60s, 70s, it was really popular as a ground cover. Now this is coming back. Really tough, and you can see, that's not such a good focus, but you can see how it spreads. Did I say it'll tolerate foot traffic? Yes. Fast growing. Chamomile? It's fast growing, yes. Chamomile, where did my chamomile go? Okay, so this chamomile is making flower stalks, but when it's not making flower stalks, it makes a really nice low carpet. And this is Rancho La Puerta. Don't you want to go with me? This is a chamomile lawn in Rancho La Puerta.
You cut it? Mow it?
You can mow it. You can mow it. But I think you would want to push mower. I would worry about the mower itself.
Sure.
Sorry that it's not in better focus. It's on a smaller screen. It's fine. But this is not irrigated. Tiny yellow flowers, it's fragrant. You can make a fragrant packet, yes.
Is there a particular kind? Mine in my garden always died back.
This is Roman chamomile.
And that's all stay year-round.
It should stay year-round. Yeah. If people really insist on lawn, you know, there's a lot of low water, quote unquote, low water grasses, lawn grasses that you'll see. Pearl's Premium Eco Lawn. Don't even go there. They're both out of Canada and the East Coast. So what's drought tolerant there ain't drought tolerant here. This is a lawn, I'm sorry to say, this is coming out of the Central Valley. I did this as a client's lawn. We planted it last year. It's the Delta Bluegrass, one of their lawns. Cost an arm and a leg. Was really expensive, and this is how it looks after just a year. I don't not acceptable for me. Not acceptable for me. Really disappointing. By the way, the owner insisted she needed a lawn for her grandchildren that are not yet born. So instead, yes.
Have you seen the low water lawn that they've put in at the San Marcos City
where the city council meets.
I have not seen that.
They've got signs out there because people keep going in and saying, what are you doing putting in lawn when we're in the midst of grass?
I'll check that out.
I just wondered, it's really long, thick grass.
Well, that might be some of the things we're going to talk about. So quickly, because we're running out of time. Okay, so this is, when we moved into our house, it was just a mess. I mean, there was nothing redeeming. There was no garden to speak of, but it was 2/3 of an acre and I couldn't resist that. So I was pregnant, as it turned out, and we had an almost toddler at the time. And so over the years, as we did our landscape, when we did the backyard, which was the first thing we did because we lived in the backyard, my husband said, well, we have to have lawn. And it's like, I don't want lawn. Okay, this is like 1992. I don't want lawn. He says, we have to have lawn because the kids are going to need it. So we put in a lawn, kind of like kidney bean shape, and we put a pathway around the lawn, a big DG pathway, one big circle. So the kids never used the lawn. They got on the pathway. They used to ride their feet. What they liked was before we had the lawn, we had all weeds, and we used to go out there and watch ladybugs crawl up and down, you know, the grass and stuff. So over time, eventually, I kept nibbling away at the lawn, and finally my son was about, I don't know, 12, he's now 25, and he says, Mom, why do we have lawn? And my great grandson said, honey, why do we have lawn? So within a month, the lawn was gone. But instead, I put in a meadow. This is Carex praegrisillus. I don't know if I find it here. It's a native, California native field sedge. I had seen it growing up at the Cal Poly San Luis Obispo in their arboretum, and they use it as a, it's a very, you know, it's a used area, it's a used space, they have events there, and they had planted part of the used area, that's the big walking area, with this, and part of it with traditional turf grass, and they mowed them both, and they were looking at experiment, looking to see how they did. I could not tell the difference. It took me to find, I had to find the seed to figure out which was grass and which wasn't. You can mow this, or you don't have to, yes.
I put that up with sedge, it reseeds all over my garden.
Depends which kind of sedge. Okay. Totally depends which kind of sedge. So this one will not reseed all over your garden.
Which one is it?
This is Carex praegrisillus. Oops.
Look at that.
Wait a minute. Uh-oh. What happened? What did I do? Sorry. Praegrisillus.
That's
a Carex. It's a Carex, yes, C-A-R-E-X. Carex praegrisillus.
It's called blue sedge, right?
Not that one.
No.
You can mow this, yes.
Is it like mounding? So if you mow it, you're going to sort of get a...
No, it's not mounded. It creeps. It creeps. And so it looks kind of like waves when you don't mow it. Mow it, and I never mow it. But if you mow it, it's just flat.
It takes foot traffic.
It takes foot traffic. Not heavy foot traffic, but it'll handle... It. Well, and there they had heavy foot traffic. I just don't put heavy foot
So
it
would work in a dog park?
I don't know if it'll work well enough in a dog park, but you could do a section of the dog park to see. And tell me what happens. All right, so this is blue sedge, Carex flacca, which is what all of these little things are. And these have been grown in a little bit of shade, so they're not as blue as they should be. But this is a great sedge. I use this often. I use this all the time in landscapes.
Yeah.
First of all, it makes a big, it makes a mat. It's only about 5 or 6 inches tall. Makes a mat, sort of gives you the idea of having water because it gets so blue. And
now how big does this grow?
6 inches maybe.
That's tall, but does it spread?
It spreads.
Does it spread a lot?
So it'll make, you can see on the left, it just creeps, it'll go,
oh, yeah,
I don't know, I plant them about 6 inches on center. Richard, you can use this?
Yeah.
6 inches on center?
Mm-hmm.
More or less?
More or less, depends how impatient you are.
And you can?
And budget.
Yeah, it depends on how impatient. patient you are, that's what I'm saying.
Is it hard?
I use it the natural.
I use it. I've cut it.
Musa tree.
No,
with
like a
hedge.
You know, something that's flat.
Eagle line, all the product is there. You can always go on there if you want.
And you can comb it every so often when you get to the
Mission Hills Nursery.
Yeah,
Mission Hills Nursery. But because you find everything online, order it online and ship it there. Depending where you live.
California Field Sedge, this is another Carex. Oh, sorry. Okay, this is the Pregnosaurus.
Most people in Mission Hills, so they don't care about it. They want to go out.
That's the one that I passed around before. Carex texensis is a lower sedge. It is this one. Catlin sedge, really nice and soft. Really, really nice and soft. This can be mowed as well. It's not fast growing, but it's a Southwest native. Only gets about 6 inches tall. Then we have the Carex tumicola, Carex divulsa, which I use all the time. I use this all the time. This is a European native. I don't use this for lawn as much as I use it. Like, I mix it with succulents. You know when you got the corner where the sidewalk comes together? And you want to soften that edge, put a big green aeonium and then plant that behind it, and it just makes a beautiful soft presentation. That gets to be about a foot tall. The Lomandras, oh my god. This is just a little one, it's a young one, Lomandra breeze. This is the best plant that's come onto the market in years. It gets to be a fountain. So you can plant this in a mass. If you want a low green area, you can't walk on it, but just like a big green negative space, which is what a lot of grasses get used for, this is awesome. By the way, the carexes are used outside here. I know there are a bunch coming in.
How tall is this one?
2 to 4, more on the 3 to 4 end, tall and wide. Sun, shade, wet, dry, slopes, it'll hold slopes in. Which is really unusual for something that is not woody.
Does it bloom at all?
It has a bloom, you wouldn't notice it. You might, but it's not flowered.
Are the roots invasive?
No, not at all. Not at all. The Cecillarias, there's 3 different Cecillarias here. They're all very similar, but they have, you know, slightly different leaf color and slightly different texture. This is Floriana. And these are more clumping. So again, you can plant these in masses, but they're drought-tolerant along the coast, not so much inland. And the differences between them, again, are kind of a little bit of color, leaf flower color, a little bit of leaf color, and the texture. You want me to back up? Sorry.
Please.
Will
this be on our training website?
I don't know. Are you making this PowerPoint presentation available to us?
I can't make the presentation, but I have to give you a version of it.
Okay, thank you. Will you?
Yes, please. You can, Will. The Cecillarias are not tall. They're only about 12 inches, maybe 15 inches tall. And they're clumping. So again, you would want to plant them as a mass, like a low green mass, rather than a lawn substitute. And this is one of the others. This is more gray. So a little of the blue bramble grass is here. Yeah. Well, the scenery helps a lot. This is a blue granite. It doesn't look awesome right now, but it looks great in the ground. A lot of these don't look so good, you know, the container, but you put them in the ground, they're amazing.
Or you get this in Bay Area wildlife.
No. Absolutely. They're all wildlife. This gets to be only 6 to 12 inches tall.
It's a little shorter.
full summer light shade, not evergreen, goes firm into the winter, yes.
Do you have any comment about all of these with rabbits?
You know, well, we had a cat. We had no rabbit problems. The cat disappeared maybe 4 years ago. I was standing in my kitchen window yesterday looking in the backyard. This has been the nasturtium, just carpet everything. And this little bunny is on my patio eating nasturtium leaves. And I'm thinking, I'm a bunny factory. It's sort of become an interesting experiment to see what they eat and what they don't eat. They don't eat my carrots at all, none of the carrots. They ate a big Lomandra. I had blades this wide that I planted a few weeks ago. It was it really tough, leathery, like, you know, fibrous leaves. I would never have expected that. A lot of these, you just have to experiment and see. You know what they say, it's like deer. If they're hungry enough, they'll eat almost anything. This is a beautiful Bundalua called Blonde Ambition. This is what makes this really fabulous. They describe these as eyelashes. I think of them more as eyebrows. But you can see they're big. They're like this.
Yeah.
It's very cool. It is. But this is not evergreen. It'll go dormant in the winter. It takes full sun.
It's a good container plant, too.
It's a good container plant, it is.
Do you cut it back and it comes
back? And then the buffalo grass. Have you ever heard of John Greenlee, the grass guy? The grassman? Yeah, so this is John Greenlee's home. Well, one of his places. This is up in Pomona. And he planted this. This is the buffalo grass as a road. It's a road through the back of his property. So they drive on this. It's only this tall.
How do you care for that? Do you have to, like,
weed whack it? Yeah, you would weed whack it. Yeah, weed whack it.
But not
great
here.
I don't think you would weed whack it. Is it your native green? The lower and the broader it is, the more adaptable it is to overhead spray. But remember, if you're going to do overhead spray, you want to go with empty rotators or one of the very low precipitation rate.
So those the ones.
Irrigation heads, yeah. You don't want to go with the old-fashioned sprinklers. I don't think they're going to be available to us after, you know, in a short period. But always recommend the low precipitation rate. If they're taller, drip irrigation. Drip irrigation. Because you got to spray over the top. It doesn't make any sense. Once you get more than about this tall, forget it.
Oh, is that good in shape?
I think so.
You can do it on your own.
It takes full sun. In this case, it took some shade, but it definitely had. It was definitely part of the full sun. It's a slow spreader. No, it's a stoloniferous one. Somebody said to me the same thing I thought when I looked at this in the container. By the way, this all comes from Green Meadow Growers. All these grasses, except for the carrots, the little ones.
Green Meadow Growers.
Really great field trip. They'd be happy to have you. They're in Bonsall, right near Euro-American.
I have a small one.
I have brochures if anybody's here. Exactly. It's a wholesale grower. It's not a retail grower. But they are a wonderful source of information. All kinds of grasses. This is just a small selection of what they have. And then they have one of the succulents for it to die from. They have this hillside as you go up to the office. I was there yesterday. This hillside, and it's planted in blocks. And there's a yellow block, and an orange block, and a pink block, and a green block.
Can you repeat the name of it? I didn't hear the name of it.
Green Meadow Growers. I have their brochures here if anybody wants. Green Meadow Growers.
Their website is excellent.
They do have a really good website. They've been working on it for a long time. These are people who know their stuff. Really great people. It does look like Bermuda grass, but it's not. Okay, so I've overwhelmed you, I know that. I apologize, but not too much. This is the Bundalua Blonde Ambition, by the way. I think the bottom line is, as I said earlier, we're in this major transition period, and it's a good thing. It's a good thing. We don't really need all this lawn. Acres and acres and acres. In fact, the guy from Promoter College is telling us that they've removed 4 acres of lawn from the periphery of the college. And they still have this beautiful big green quad, you see it on the show. They're leaving the lawn in the use areas, they're getting rid of it everywhere else. It just makes sense. It just makes sense. So you guys are a major interface to the public. You're part of this bad, I don't think it was a bad crusade. It's not even that wave, right? Transition. It's a good thing. So I want to thank you all for listening and for asking great questions. I'm here to answer more questions. You know, and you have my email, contact me anytime. Yes. Okay, so Don just asked me to tell you a story that I made sure you remember. When I was getting rid of my lawn, I used Roundup. Okay? I used Roundup and I had the blue colorant. And I talked to actually the woman, the biologist who worked at Monsanto about all this, and she had kids and dogs and whatever, and I said, why is it tells you to keep dogs and kids off the lawn, you know, off the area that you sprayed? And she said, because it's not for their health, it's because they're gonna trap it, you know, off the plants. And so when the day I sprayed Roundup, in my garden to get rid of the lawn, everybody was asleep. I got up at like 5:30 in the morning, put on my gear, blah, blah, blah. Went out there with my blue color and sprayed everything. And, you know, as the sun comes up and the leaves dry, you know, once that happens, then it's fine. They can go walk on there, et cetera. So I had left the dog in the house. You know how your dog always knows what you're doing and they want to follow you? So we had this cat, we had this hound, Howie the hound. He was like this tall. It was wonderful. But so Howie wanted to come outside with me, but of course I locked him in the house. And I sprayed, and then I went in the house, the kids were watching cartoons, and I went and I sat down with them, and at some point my daughter says to me, Mom, why is Howie all blue? Howie had found his way out of the house, and he had found his way down to the meadow, and he had done his business and whatever, but he was he was like caramel color, you know? And Howie was blue. That's the story. Yes.
And I had a question about seeding.
Yeah.
Have you found any of these to become kind of weedy as far as the seeds, any setting seeds or?
Somebody else just asked me that. No. I haven't used all of them, but the ones I've used, I have not had a problem with. It's not like Pennisetum that seeds everywhere. Some of the Carexes do receive, you said that, right? Carex Testacea, the orange one, that will receive. Which ones have you used?
I think it was the
black one. Tumacola, you've had that received?
Yes.
I haven't.
I wasn't supposed to. That's why I've gotten turned off on the sedges.
So I'll tell you one thing about sedges. They look so similar that they're not always labeled correctly. So it could be that the one you got was not labeled correctly. But you know, nut sedge, that horrible weed that we all have? That's a carex. Okay, so you know, it's like everything else. Plant in place, behaves appropriately. I know somebody who has nut sedge and they're so fed up with trying to control it, they just mow it. It's like, okay, it's part of the landscape, I'm just gonna mow it. But it's, you always have to be aware of the fact that some of these things, when the nurseries will tell you, oh, that's sterile, mostly what they mean is, we've never found a seedling, or maybe we found a couple. Because even, you know, Pampas, and this is something you guys should know about, there are cultivars of Pampas that they sell in the nursery, judge me, bonkers. The variegated, the dwarfs, and they say, oh no, all of those cultivars, they're sterile. They're not sterile. It means the growers haven't found the seedlings in the nursery, but there's a woman up at UC Davis who's a researcher, and she did a study a number of years ago where she went around and she collected all of those nursery cultivars that are sold, and then she went out into the wild and she sampled the wild Pampas, and she did a DNA analysis on all of them, and she found the DNA from the nursery cultivars in the wild growing Pampas. There's only one way that happens, if they're crossing. And if they're crossing, it means they're not sterile. So sterility is a relative thing. Thank you so much.